So in this video, I'll talk about solar cells, and we'll do some basic current versus voltage measurements of solar cells so that you can see that it's not anything like a battery. Now, first of all, solar cells, before they're packaged, are incredibly thin. So I'm holding here a silicon solar cell, and the first thing you might notice is that the top side is kind of dark. You know, silicon on its own is not dark, it's metallic. So this has an anti-reflection coating. An ideal solar cell would be black because it would absorb all the sunlight and convert it to electricity. These white areas on the solar cell are bus bars. This is one of the contacts. So this is actually something like silver paint. Electrical contact is made on these two junctions, and electricity passes out of the solar cell. The backside also has an electrical contact. In this case, there are two bus bars running along the backside. When these solar cells are packaged into a cell, typically there would be several of these solar cells wired up in series. So we've got an example here of a solar panel consisting of 8 individual solar cells wired in series, and this particular solar cell was fabricated here at the National University of Singapore at CERIS, the Solar Research Institute. We have 8 individual solar cells all wired in series. Each one of these cells consists of a silicon wafer that was cut in half. I turn it around to the back, we can see the backside, and in solar cells that you would buy on the market, typically the backside would not be transparent, but they've been so kind as to make an example for us so that we could see how the backside is typically connected. Now, on the back of the solar cell are some words that characterize the solar cell, and there are 4 key parameters: the short circuit current, the open circuit voltage, and the current and voltage at the maximum power point. The power at the maximum power point is about 19 watts in full sunlight. So if we hook the solar cell up to a resistor and the resistance value allows the maximum power to be dissipated, we want to make sure that we use a resistor with a high enough power rating. Now, later when we go outside, I'll take some resistors with me, and I'm going to use these power resistors. These are 47 ohm resistors, and each one of them can dissipate 10 watts. So that means if they're wired in series, for example, they would be able to dissipate 40 watts, and if they were wired in parallel, they would also be able to dissipate 40 watts. A solar cell is an example of a nonlinear circuit element. It's also a power source. So to really contrast this difference, let's consider a voltage source and a solar cell. First, I'm going to graph the IV characteristics of both the voltage source and a typical solar cell. An ideal voltage source is linear. The voltage stays constant even as the current increases. A solar cell, on the other hand, is not. A solar cell has more of an elliptical or a circular shape, if you will. If I were to hook a resistor up to a voltage source and change the resistance, then the current would also change. For example, if I use a certain resistor, then it would have the same voltage of operation as another resistor. The only thing that would change is the current. If I were to then consider the power supplied by the voltage source and graph that with respect to the current, I would also get a straight line, because at zero current, no power flows. Power equals voltage times current. And then as the current grows, if the voltage stays constant, then the power increases linearly. Let's now consider the situation in a solar cell. If I hook a resistor up to a solar cell and then change the resistance, then both the voltage will change and the current will change. If I then plot the power versus current for a solar cell, I'll have an interesting situation, because when the current is nearly zero, the power supplied by the cell is also zero. No current's flowing, no power's flowing. But when the current is high, the voltage is decreased to zero. Since voltage equals zero, the power is also zero. So a solar cell has something called a maximum power point, a point where if you use just the right resistor, you'll have the maximum power flowing out of a solar cell. Now, this creates a lot of problems for solar cell or solar panel installers, because you always want to extract the maximum possible power from your solar cell. But unfortunately, when the sun is brighter, you have clouds, or the sun is dimmer, then the entire curve for the cell shifts, with the current usually shifting a lot more than the voltage. But the maximum power point is then shifting all over the place. Also, if the load changes, then the point of operation could shift. This all makes using solar cells in a circuit a little bit complicated because electronics have to monitor this maximum power point, which is drifting due to the amount of power or the sunlight falling on the cell. Now let's go over to the bench and do a simple experiment with an LED. I'm going to hook a solar cell up to a blue LED. What I'll do is I'll cover up part of the solar panel and we'll see what happens to the brightness of the LED. I think what you'll notice right away is that the power that can be produced by the solar panel varies quite a lot with the amount of light falling on the panel. So I'm going to do a very simple experiment here to show that the power coming out of the solar cell is indeed somehow proportional to the amount of light falling onto the panel here. So I've got an LED, this is a blue LED, and it turns out that the size of this solar cell is just nice to give a fair amount of light from this one LED. As I start to cover up some of the cells, you would be able to notice that indeed the LED is getting dimmer. What we've seen is that even here in the lab, if I change the amount of light falling on a solar panel, I can get a different amount of power output from the solar cell. We saw that with the LED. Let's now do an experiment where we take the full VI curve, both indoors and outdoors, and we can compare the amount of power we can get from these solar panels. Now, I'm going to first characterize this solar cell indoors before we take it outside. I have the multimeter here set to milliamps, so we're indoors, there's not going to be very much power. I'm going to measure the short circuit current of this solar panel. So it looks like we're getting about 9.5 milliamps for the short circuit current. I'm going to now switch it to voltage. Let's measure the open circuit voltage. And I see 3.7 volts. I'm now going to do two measurements with resistors as the load attached to the solar cell. So right now, the solar panel is connected to four 47 ohm resistors wired in series, and I'm going to check the voltage. And in office lighting, it looks like we have about 1.53 volts. I'm now going to change it to two 47 ohms resistors wired in series. And the voltage is now around 0.85 volts or so. Okay, now let's go outside and do the same measurements of open circuit voltage and short circuit current, and also one measurement of the LI curve with these power resistors. All right, so I'm outside here, and I'm going to do three measurements with the solar cell. I'm going to first measure the short circuit current, then the open circuit voltage, and then we'll put a resistor in and we'll see how much the voltage is. All right, so first of all, the short circuit current, and it looks like we're reading about 4.28 amperes, and as I change the amount of light falling on the cell, of course, then the short circuit current is changing. Let's now measure the open circuit voltage. I'm just going to move it over to voltage. And it looks like our open circuit voltage is about 4.81 volts. Of course, as I change the amount of light falling on the cell, then the voltage will be reduced a bit. All right, for the third measurement, I've got four power resistors. They're all 47 ohms. And they're hooked up in parallel. And we'll be measuring the voltage. Under a full equatorial sunlight, we're measuring about 4.56 volts. All right, now let's go back inside and compare the amount of power we're getting out of the cell outdoors with the amount of power we got indoors. So But now that we've done the experiment both indoors and outdoors, we can compare these two graphs. And it's really interesting. You might notice that whereas indoors we were able to extract a few milliwatts of power from the solar panel, when we put it outside in full sunlight, we were getting amps and volts. In other words, we were able to extract a few watts from the solar panel. This is literally 1,000 times difference. And you might wonder, wow, you know, that's a huge difference in the amount of power coming out of the solar panel. And that's something that it's not so easy to see with the human eye. You might think, oh, inside it's fairly bright and outside it's fairly bright. It is literally 1,000 times brighter outdoors than it is indoors. It's just that the human eye has such good automatic gain control that we don't notice it. But the solar panel notices, and there is really a lot more light outdoors that can be used than indoors. So what I hope you've learned from this video are two things. First of all, you can't really use solar panels indoors unless you only need a very small amount of power. Solar panels can really only be used outdoors in full sunlight. Secondly, the IV characteristic of a solar panel is complicated. It's complicated because it's nonlinear. It's complicated because the curve shifts depending on the amount of light falling on the solar panel. And it's also complicated because the point of maximum power shifts depending on the load and the amount of light falling on the panel. We have a whole series of professionally filmed and edited videos in order to help students learn the fundamentals of electricity. If you like watching this particular video, then you might like to check out some of our others too.